What is up, everybody? It's time for another cool programs video, and today I've got a whopping 10 of them, all free programs for Windows. So you should at least find some of them useful, even if you don't need all of them, and of course I'll put all links in the description. Before we jump in, of course I have to do my usual plugs. If you haven't seen my truly amazing Instagram account, you're really missing out. It has the most hilarious tech memes you could possibly imagine, so be sure to check that out. It's just at TheoJoe over on Instagram. Also, if you want to support my work and get some cool perks too, consider becoming a channel member by clicking the join button, and you'll get my videos early as soon as I finish them, a badge to show off in the comments, and a special member rank in my Discord server, which if you didn't know about, you can join by going to discord.gg/TheoJoe. So I hope to see you over there. And with all that out of the way though, let's get started. So number one is a program called Qt Tab Bar, which adds a feature to Windows Explorer that honestly Microsoft should have added years ago, but somehow has not, which is tabbed Explorer windows. Instead of having a bunch of individual windows that you need to switch between, you can just click a tab like you do in any web browser, which makes way more sense. Now, after you install it, one thing that took me a lot of searching to figure out is to actually enable it, you need to go to the taskbar view tab and then options dropdown and actually click Qt Tab Bar to enable it or else it won't show up. And also there are other command bar options you can click here to enable, but I don't like the look of those and I don't need them, so I just keep them disabled, but you might see those options here. But for the most part, after you enable it, Explorer should still look the same and behave the same, so just with some extra elements. So obviously you can see that the tabs are there now, and when you hover over folders now, sometimes there will be a little arrow showing internal folders if you hover over them, so you can just ignore them. I don't know if there's a way to turn that off, that's just part of the program. And to open a new tab, you just right click on a folder and click open in new tab, or you can middle click the folder and it will also open in a new tab. It might be a little bit faster. So it's very similar to how browsers work with multiple tabs. All right, next up we have Music Bee, which is a music manager kind of like iTunes, but not. So if you don't have an iPhone, this could be a good option to keep track of all your music. It's got a nice looking modern interface and will automatically import your music and do all the usual stuff like organizing by album, artist, and all that. And it's also got a good amount of advanced features like multiband equalizers, skins, tools for tagging and CD ripping, and even support for Winamp plugins. And yes, you can actually use it to sync with your phone if it runs Android, so it could definitely do a lot. Okay, for number three, we have a cool one called GOG Galaxy, which is a universal game manager from the website GOG, aka Good Old Games, which, fun fact, is actually owned by the same company that developed the Witcher games and the upcoming Cyberpunk 2077. And this is actually the newly released GOG Galaxy 2.0 version. Basically, this program aims to let you connect all your different game services and manage everything from one place. So this includes Steam, Origin, Epic Games, and even console platforms like PlayStation and Xbox accounts. You're able to import all your games, friends lists, and achievements, and whatever else from all the various platforms. Now, each platform has different levels of integration, so with most platforms, you can at least see which friends are online, for example, and soon you'll be able to do cross-platform chatting. Some platforms like Steam also let you install and uninstall games right from GOG Galaxy, and even does cloud save backups for some games. There is a lot more it can do that I don't have time to go over in this video, but it's definitely worth checking out considering how many different game platforms there are these days. Up next, we actually have several programs, all part of a suite that I'll just count as one, which is known as SysInternals. And this is actually a set of tools created by Microsoft themselves for Windows, though it isn't included with Windows and has to be downloaded separately. There are a ton of programs in here, literally around 70, I think, so some more useful than others. So I'll just go over some of the more useful ones. And the good news is, most of these are standalone and don't require installation. You can just run them. One extremely powerful tool is called Process Monitor, which basically allows you to keep track and see exactly what actions every single process on the computer does, which is invaluable when trying to debug programs or figure out why something keeps crashing, for example. Now, I should warn you, this is only going to be helpful to advanced users, and most of you will probably have absolutely no idea what you're looking at. Hell, even I don't really know 99% of what it says, because it's kind of information overload. You're better off just reading tutorials dedicated on how to use this program, because I don't want to spend the whole video on it. Another useful program is Process Explorer, which you can kind of think of like a super version of Task Manager. It can do a lot of the same stuff, like seeing running processes, killing processes, but can do a lot more like seeing which files a program is actively using, stuff like that. Again, you'll have to research the app separately to realize its full power. Then there are a ton of other little programs in the suite, a lot of which just serve single functions, and some of them are kind of funny, such as the one called Not My Fault, which literally is meant to purposefully crash the computer in a variety of ways to test things out. Just be sure to use that one responsibly if you decide to prank your friends with it. Okay, next up for number 5, this one is actually similar to the Process Explorer tool I just mentioned, and it's called Process Hacker. This is pretty much the same idea, where it shows all running processes, can show parent-child process relations, and all that. But it is a bit more powerful with more options and abilities. For example, it has separate tabs not just for processes, but also services and network connections and disk activity. And you can also use it to see memory contents of different processes, which I won't pretend to understand, but some of you out there can probably take good advantage of it. And I've heard it's especially useful when it comes to diagnosing and removing viruses, if you have the know-how, of course. Moving on, number 6 is a popular one you might have heard of already, which is LibreOffice. It's essentially a free alternative to the Microsoft Office suite of programs, and this is another group of programs we'll just count as one. Some of the stuff it includes are Writer, which is a word processor, Calc for spreadsheets, Impress for presentations like PowerPoint, and also Draw for diagrams, Base for databases, Math for formulas, and some other stuff. And yes, it can actually open and save the same formats as Microsoft Office, like DocX for Word example. Though keep in mind, if you do a lot of complicated documents with lots of weird formatting, there might be the occasional formatting difference if it's opened in Word, but that's bound to be expected. All right, up to number 7, we have the program TreeSize, which helps you map your hard drive and figure out stuff like where all your free space has gone. It's similar to another program I'm a big fan of called WindearStat, but this one is just different, so you might prefer it. It will show you the size of different directories on your drive, and you can also see it as a visual representation to see nested directories, which are visually bigger based on storage size. I think I'd still prefer WindearStat just because I'm familiar with it, but you might decide you like the look of this one better. All right, number 8 is really cool, which is Game Save Manager, and it's pretty much just like it sounds. Its purpose is to let you automatically back up all your video game save files at once and restore them too. It should support pretty much every single game you can imagine, and they have a list on their website, and there's literally over 6,000 games on there, which is pretty crazy, and their website also shows the last time they updated the database. It's got a bunch of other cool features, like the ability to tie in with cloud services like Dropbox, the ability to do scheduled backups, and will also let you know if there's any special circumstances with certain games, like with Minecraft. It lets you know that it will back up the entire Minecraft world folder because it has to for a true backup, so obviously that might be more storage than you expect. So this is definitely one that could be useful if you ever need to move save files to a new computer or share them with friends or just back them up and you don't want to have to figure out where all the save files are. Coming near the end, we got a couple more still. So for number 9, we have MSI Afterburner, which is a very useful program for controlling your graphics card, including overclocking. And keep in mind, you can use this program no matter what graphics card you have. It doesn't have to be made by MSI. It will display a lot of information about the GPU, like current clock speed, voltage, temperature, fan speed, stuff like that. Then it makes it really easy to overclock just using some basic sliders like power limit, core voltage, temperature limits, core clock, and memory clock, and fan speed controls too. Now remember, just because the slider is there doesn't mean that you can just max everything out and expect it to magically triple your graphics power. You're better off looking up some overclocking guides for your specific GPU, because you probably can't increase these things as much as you imagine without making the system unstable. So maybe try increasing stuff just bit by bit, probably starting with power limit, which I've had reasonable success with. But be especially careful with the voltage limits, because setting that too high could potentially damage your card. Again, you'll want to definitely do some research before messing around with this too much, even though it is very powerful. All right, finally, we're up to number 10, which could be the most useful of them all. And this program is called Super F4, and its purpose is to allow you to kill the foreground process if a program freezes or refuses to quit. Now, you probably already know if this happens, there are options such as using Control-Alt-Delete to bring up the task manager, but sometimes even that can be difficult, like if it's a full screen program that won't go away and is blocking you from even seeing the task manager. Pro tip though, in the task manager, you can enable the always on top option to make that less likely. In any case, if all else fails, Super F4 lets you just use the shortcut Control-Alt-F4 to force quit the application if it refuses to do so by itself,